As with any other system in the universe, an electron in an H atom will naturally tend to be on the lowest energy state. That's the ground state, or N equals one. If this was always the case, though, how could we ever see Balmer transitions? For example, in absorption. For us to see Balmer series in absorption, we actually require electrons to be in N equals two, for example. Or to see Balmer series in emission, we actually require electrons to go down to N equals two, meaning they have to be at an even higher energy. Now, this means that atoms can be excited by absorbing specific photons, or de-excited by emitting photons. Physically, the way that we can predict whether an atom, at least in a statistical sense, will have its electrons at some energy N plus one versus some energy level N is through the Boltzmann equation that you can see here. Now, the Boltzmann equation will essentially depend on this exponential term. It also contains a minus that is important, and it's 1 over T. What this tells you is that temperature is the greatest predictor for an atom to be excited or to have its electrons at some N plus 1 level instead of N. Specifically, the full Boltzmann equation looks like this. You will find in the lecture notes all the details about terms. The Boltzmann equation is not that complicated. You'll find on top the energies for the energy levels that you're calculating. This is the Boltzmann constant. And also, these factors have to do with the probability of electrons being on different states to do with the degeneracy between states. For neutral hydrogen, this is relatively simple. You can see it here, and we're going to calculate for a few specific examples. Now, what this all tells us is that at higher temperatures, electrons will tend to be in increasingly higher levels. The higher the temperature, the more excited you are expected to find an atom. And this creates the conditions necessary for de-excitation and emission of photons to lower levels. Of course, it also means, and this is crucial, that if we know the temperature, we can predict the occupation probabilities, and we can also revert this. Essentially, if we measure the emission and absorption lines that tell us something about this ratio, then if we know the atom we're looking at, we can actually infer the temperature through spectroscopy. Now, it's obvious that if we can see some emission lines, something must be exciting it. And there's different ways that you can excite an atom. On one hand, you can just shoot high energy photons at it, and that will excite the atoms, and then the electrons will start to go down and emit photons. The other way is doing it thermally by essentially heating up the material. There are plenty of examples, both near and far. For example, on Earth, we can actually find auroras that result from the de-excitation of oxygen atoms once they're bombarded by the solar wind, for example. We can also find H2 regions, and I told you already that this red, this typical red, comes from H alpha emission, from de-excitation, from essentially N equals three to N equals two. And we also find de-excitation, for example, in Saturn's ultraviolet aurora coming out in Lyman alpha. So from the Lyman series, meaning the final energy level was N equals one, and the delta of levels was one as well. So transition from N equals two to N equals one. We've seen how essentially the Boltzmann equation allows us to statistically predict the occupation, or sort of the fraction of electrons that are at some higher level versus lower level. And this allows us to quantify the excitation level. If we do the calculations, we can actually look at the probability of some atom emitting some photon, because that is associated with a significant population of electrons at a specific level. Now, say that actually, apart from being excited, your atoms are being bombarded or absorbing such high energy photons that they're receiving more than the binding energy. If this happens, what you're actually doing is not just exciting the atoms, but ionizing them. Now, the important question is, how do you quantify the ratio of ionized to neutral atoms of a specific element? And the answer is just above me. We do not use the Boltzmann equation. It is actually similar, but with some important differences. This is the full Saha equation, And perhaps the most important thing to point out to begin with is the dependence on temperature. So you will find something very similar to the Boltzmann equation. It's a negative. On top is now the ionization energy, because it's the energy that you require to essentially take anything from n equals one to become ionized. It depends on temperature in the same way as Boltzmann, but there's an extra temperature dependence, meaning that the fraction of ionized, that's the two, and I'll explain this better, to non-ionized, goes up very strongly with temperature, even higher than excitation. The full Saha equation is given here. You have all the details in the lecture notes. I'll encourage you to have a look at what all these terms are if you're interested. You do not need to memorize any of these equations, of course, but the Saha equation is crucial, for example, to predict for an hydrogen atom, and this is what you're seeing here in this plot, what is the ionization fraction as you increase the temperature. So what the Saha equation really tells you is that below temperatures of something like 6 and definitely 5,000 Kelvin, pretty much all hydrogen atoms are neutral. But as you go to higher temperatures, this fraction starts rising very, very quickly. And by the time you get to something like 15,000 Kelvin, pretty much all hydrogen atoms are ionized. This is because of the very strong temperature dependence. Now, it is important to note that you will encounter this notation that you see here. The two typically means singly ionized. And if you see a one, that means neutral. And here, just see a quick summary of simple conclusions you would take if you use the Saha equation for example, a cloud of hydrogen. Now, what's really exciting about astrophysics, once you start dealing with the Boltzmann and Saha equation, is that you can actually infer detailed physical conditions by measuring line strengths. And you realize that you actually need both excitation and ionization. Perhaps the plot that's just next to me conveys that quite nicely. And we'll see this for the specific case of hydrogen. Now, what happens is, as a function of temperature for any atom, your electrons will tend to be at higher and higher levels. The atom becomes more and more excited. But the important thing to note is that as temperature goes up, so does the probability of your atom becoming ionized. If it is ionized, it is no longer a neutral atom being excited. So this leads to this behavior, actually. As you increase temperature for any specific, in this case, their absorption lines, they're essentially telling you about the amount of electrons at a specific n, because you need it to then absorb and then transition to a higher level. For example, for hydrogen, so this is the line strength as a function of temperature, if we start with smaller temperatures and then go up, we'll see that this Balmer lines, the age lines, will go up very strongly, because due to the Boltzmann equation, you expect many more electrons to be at n equals 2 as you rise the temperature. But at some point, ionization starts to really matter. At some temperature, and specifically getting close to something like 10,000 Kelvin, there will be so many atoms that are now become ionized that they no longer have electrons at n equals 2 to lead to this absorption feature. Therefore, even though if you interpret Boltzmann equation at face value, you'd expect more and more and more electrons to be at n equals 2 than n equals 1, the reality is that most atoms, when you go to the highest temperatures, are simply ionized, and therefore the lines go down. This behavior is actually found at all kinds of lines or even ions. For example, in the sun, this line of singly ionized calcium is actually quite strong, and it is strongest actually for stars of temperatures around 5,000 Kelvin. One of the difficulties, though, of trying to just use spectroscopy to infer a temperature is that the strength of a line always has sort of two solutions. If you measure a specific strength, for example, for hydrogen, it could either mean that this is something like 14,000 Kelvin or perhaps 8,000 Kelvin. The way to deal with this is if you measure more than one line, say, for example, you measure hydrogen and then you also measure calcium. If you measure at least two of them, then you can actually break the degeneracy.